Thank you very much, Chip, for that kind introduction. It's very nice to be here. I came in yesterday and it was lovely weather. It was overcast at 65 degrees and I felt right at home, even though I had left Portland where it had been 100 and it was like, it's not supposed to get this way in Portland. Our house guest said, you don't have air conditioning? I said, well, for 5 days a year, why would you? And it's really nice to be here, and thank you for the warm welcome. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how our program developed and a little thoughts that I have about rural general surgery and the future of general surgery in general. And so it'll be kind of a fast run through a whole lot of things, and I hope I get this right. There we go. So they always ask you to send objectives, and I sent objectives. Probably you can answer all these things already, but hopefully there'll be a few little things that you can get out of some of the comments that I'm going to say in the next next few minutes here. And it's really about why preserving general surgery is, in my opinion, so important, and how you can potentially get some more people to stay in general surgery, and the attractiveness of rural surgery. And just a little word about that, there's a close connection really between training for rural surgery and global surgery, which is also a very big interest of a lot of folks nowadays as our world has become flat and globalized and there's a lot of need recognized. But there's a lot of need here domestically as well, as we all recognize. And so having good general surgeons in the community to take care of folks, I think, is really important. And how can we potentially do that? I have nothing to disclose, except I have a bias in favor of surgeons, especially general surgeons, and especially rural general surgeons. And actually, my early roots in this little town of 3,000 play a part in why I have such an affection for rural surgeons, and that is I wouldn't be here today if there hadn't been a rural surgeon who could take care of my mom when she had a ruptured ectopic 8 years before I was born. And she had most of her blood in her abdomen and had a rare blood type, and she was still able to be saved. But if there'd been nobody out in that little community, she wouldn't have been. So I'm particularly fond of rural general surgeons for that reason. And I'm a general surgeon, and I'm darn proud of it. I was also a colorectal surgeon, but kind of a general surgeon in disguise as a colorectal surgeon. And I was the general surgery program director for 20 years, which was a long sentence. And also, I think I'm going to hope to present the case for why we need more general surgeons in the future, especially in rural areas. Or do we? What is the evidence for whether we need? I mean, some people would say, just transfer everybody. Well, problem with that is you get the call, they want to send them, but you don't have any beds because all the beds are full. And so that's a problem. We have to really have some capability of taking care of the routine things and the emergency things, the people who would otherwise die, like ruptured ectopic pregnancies and aneurysms and traumas from tractor accidents and things like that. So there was a big hue and cry, there has been now for about 20 years, about the death of general surgery as we have more and more people going into specialties. The 80% of residents doing fellowships, and I'm going to talk a tiny little bit about that too and some of the reasons for that. So all over the world, actually, too, one of these articles was from the Netherlands, and even in Europe and other parts of the world, they have the same issue. People really want to go into general surgery. For about a decade here, we've had the recognition that there's a physician shortage looming. This has been a kind of a waxing and waning problem over the 40 years of my surgical career, where way back in the 60s and 70s, there are not enough doctors, and so they built more medical schools. And then there were too many doctors, so they had the balanced budget agreement in 1997, so they put a hold on everything. And then the population kept growing, and the increase in what we could do in medicine began to increase. And then there was the 80-hour work week. And then there was the generational thing, and people don't want to work those many hours. And so there are accumulating studies here over the last decade that there is an overall physician shortage, a specific shortage in emergency care, emergency surgical care, and then the real problem here that I'm addressing today, which is the serious shortage of rural surgeons. 25% of the population live in rural areas, but there's only 9 to 12% of the workforce there. So the demographics, some articles back about 8 or so years ago, looking at the demographics of general surgeons in the US from 1981 to 2005, and looking at it per 100,000 population. And it showed that up until even 10 years ago, there'd been a drop of 26% in the surgeon workforce across the United States. And the trajectory for general surgeons just overall was, if nothing changed, that we would be down to 3.4 surgeons per 100,000 population by the year 2021. So what the correct number is perhaps a little arguable. Different estimates say that it should be somewhere to 4.7 to 6 surgeons per 100,000 population. The caveats, though, are these figures are overall ratios for the U.S., and geographic maldistribution is really rampant. George Sheldon and the American College of Surgeons Health Policy Research Institute in North Carolina at Chapel Hill did some work looking at AMA master files and plotting out where surgeons were practicing in the United States based upon the AMA master files. That was non-federal, clinically active, non-resident physicians less than 80 years of age who declared a primary specialty classified as general surgery. So this map of all the counties of the United States shows the maldistribution. Green is good on this, and the greener the better. And you look across broad swaths of the United States on this map, and you see a lot of clear white areas. Those are areas with no general surgeons. And this is not, I mean, they're underpopulated areas in a lot of cases. So you'd say, well, there are no people, they don't need general surgeons. But this is surgeons per 100,000 population. This was 2006, and so you'd say, well, okay, what happened since 2006? Well, the latest actual geographic maps like this that have been published were from actually 5 years ago, 2011. But it kind of looks even worse. It's certainly no better. And if you compare the two, the percent change in general surgeons per 100,000 population just between the years 2006 and 2011, if it is white, there were none either year, and then you see kind of a patchwork quilt here of colors of percent change in general surgeons. And if you boil it down to what happened during this time frame, there were 696 counties that gained surgeons. Those were mostly urban. There were 1,139 that saw a decline in surgeons, and there were 206 that lost all their surgeons, and 938 who had no surgeons either year. So it's a big variation across the U.S. And in places like Madison and Portland, we have maybe 40 or 50 general surgeons per 100,000, or maybe even more in some cases. But in some places, there are none. So what is the appropriate number? Well, somewhere around 4.7 to 6 and per 100,000 population. According to these estimates, most geographic areas currently have an appropriate supply of general surgeons, but the exception is rural areas. And those people there were two of our rural surgeons that were spending their year out in grants pass in our rural program that was our flagship program for rural surgery that has since expanded that I'll be talking about in a little bit. So troubling facts about access to rural surgical care in America is depending whether it's 20 or 25% of the U.S. population live in rural areas. It depends on how you define a rural area. We can have a rural area in Portland that's pretty, and in Madison as well, I understand, within 20 minutes of the city. But, it depends on the proximity to an actual larger area. But only 7% lives of general surgeons live and work in the really remote or rural areas. And the average age of those surgeons is older than the average age of surgeons in general, which is more like 45 or 47. They're more like 55. And they're kind of retiring a little fast here. But out of 1,200 newly minted general surgeons each year in this country, only about 12 will go to a rural area to practice. So many rural areas already have a shortage of surgeons, and it only threatens to worsen. But if to recruit somebody to practice in a rural area, it does require comfort with a rural environment and an expanded skill set. And so what about rural general surgery? Why is it important? A rural surgeon provides irreplaceable access to meet acute care needs of a community, and not all rural patients can or should travel to the big city for all their surgical care. Small rural surgeons rely on the presence of a surgeon for survival. If they don't have a surgeon on their staff, the hospital will frequently close because the surgeon is the person who provides the means of support for a lot of that hospital. And a rural hospital is an economic engine for a rural community. It's usually the largest or the second largest employer after the schools, unless you have Epic in your town, which we have in Oregon now down the Columbia Gorge. We have Google going to a little tiny town because they have ready access to energy from the Columbia River and the electricity. And so they're putting a huge call center and in this little tiny town. But so they become very important. But that town needs a better hospital then because they have a lot more people. So it's very important. But rural surgery is endangered. As I mentioned, the workforce is aging. The trend towards subspecialization is increasing. And most surgical residency programs are biased toward subspecialization because that's where, in academic centers, a lot of specialists work. And as is true here, it's also true in Oregon that you can't take a patient to the operating room or do anything without getting a CAT scan first. And a lot of times, lots of consultants and things like that. So, and most surgical residency training programs don't prepare residents for rural surgery practice, but they're just as you are and we are, they're starting to do so. Surgery residents do 80% do fellowships. Why do they do that? The reasons are complex and multiple. The positive news is that they do that because they love the specialty. They want to be an expert and feel there's too much to learn in general surgery. Faculty often tell them they should specialize, and specialist faculty are their role models. And it's really great when you're working side by side and it's really exciting, and your faculty member is a specialist to want to do that. So it is other reasons as well are the perceived prestige, better income, or better lifestyle, maybe. Bring up the possibility of desiring to avoid call. Maybe that is something to do with it, I don't know. It's interesting though, because now with the shortage of general surgeons everywhere, if you look at the initial salary offers and benefit offers for rural or general surgery practice, they're really very high. So the marketplace is beginning to be alert to that, and I know there's an article that came out of Wisconsin here that was done in conjunction with Oregon that showed that there was a disconnect between what was really available as a new jobs in general surgery and what the people were actually specializing in during their residency. So how do you attract students and residents to a career in rural surgery? There are several articles that address this that show that factors that increase the likelihood of practicing rural surgery are growing up in a rural area, training in a broad-based program, having rural rotations during residency, having a spouse from a rural area, and having hobbies of fishing and hunting birds and large game. So those are things that are characteristic of people who practice in a rural area. So the challenges are to attract students and residents to a career in rural surgery. And then to do that, you really need to provide training that prepares them and makes them be comfortable practicing in a rural setting. And then there are also some additional things that are very important that are not always the case, and that the American College of Surgeons and Advisory Council for Rural Surgery are working on. And in each area where there is a need, I think it does need to be addressed, and I'll mention this at the very end, making the workplace in a rural setting such that it is attractive to work there and to stay there. You need an adequate support structure and a way of not becoming burned out and having continual career development and success. So the reality in the rural sites is that there are fewer consultants and specialists, so people have to be comfortable in a broader range of skills and have the confidence to use them. A very large proportion of the practice in rural areas is endoscopy, so the training has to be especially rich and robust in endoscopy and not just the minimum of 50 colonoscopies and 35 upper endoscopies, which doesn't make you that comfortable probably doing both diagnostic and therapeutic endoscopy. Also in the rural areas, practice volume varies greatly. It can be in the most remote frontier areas really not very robust, but it also can be quite busy. And then it can vary from different times of the year, and in different communities it can vary. So the income is usually lower a little bit than in urban areas, but so is the cost of living extremely lower. The main issue that has been shown to be the greatest reason why surgeons leave rural practice is the incessant continual call. And so burnout in rural areas is fairly real, and that is a problem that needs to be solved both locally and nationally in order to preserve rural surgery. So, but it starts with having people well prepared to be able to go out and train and work in a rural setting. And that requires strong general surgery training in a program like you have here, like I think we have in Portland, where, I mean, we have a lot of fellows in Portland, and fellows, you know, definitely do have an impact on general surgery training. So having fewer competing learners is helpful for the general surgery residents. Having lots of endoscopy available during training is very important. And for rural surgery, where there aren't specialists in urology, ENT, ortho, hand, OBGYN, you need to have exposure to those sometime during your training so you can actually take care of the common problems that come up, particularly being able to do C-sections. A lot of places where rural surgeons work, there are no OBGYNs and family doctors do the deliveries, but For C-sections, some of them are equipped to do that and some aren't. And there are definitely no gastroenterologists, and there are often no specialists. So treating the common problems, the general surgeon needs to be able to do that. So optimal program models would be community residencies who don't have specialty programs, such as over here at Gundersen Lutheran or the University of North Dakota, not that far away, that have both strong core general surgery training and then one-on-one ability to work during their training with faculty in the specialties, and then rural electives, and also practice management experience, because still in rural areas there are people who are in who have their own solo practice or small group or partnerships, and they still need to know how to run their practices, as opposed to most of the multi-specialty or large groups that are practicing in the big cities. So the story of rural surgery training in Oregon is kind of an example of how you can hopefully provide training for rural surgery still within an urban academic training program. And I'm going to tell that story very quickly here. Oregon is the ninth largest geographic area of all the U.S. states. It seems like not that big, but it really is really quite large. But there are only 4 million people. But three-quarters of that population lives in the I-5 corridor, which is just right along the Cascade Mountains, right just west of the Cascade Mountains, Portland, Salem, Eugene, Medford, and so on. And there are broad expanses in the east that have more jackrabbits than people, and a few small hospitals. And then the west coast, the coast has is dotted with a bunch of little towns and a bunch of little critical access hospitals, 25 beds or less. We have 26 critical access hospitals in Oregon. So those are the expanses that are often devoid of surgeons or at risk of losing their general surgeon. And the initial impetus to develop our program went way back into the 1990s, when as program director, I started to get requests from rural surgeons, and Don Trunke got requests from rural surgeons. We need help, we need partners, we need to have someone to replace us. And also our medical school was going through a curriculum revision. It's going through another one now, but it was going through one then. And they added, at that time, a required rural clerkship in family medicine. And so the medical students all had to go out and do a rural rotation somewhere. And that was our opportunity to get to see. There were a lot of medical students that were interested. They'd get out there and they'd say, hey, you know, yeah, rural family medicine is fine, but I was hanging out in the ER the surgeon said, come to the OR and let's do this case together. And then they'd get hooked and they'd say, wow, this was really a lot more fun. Of course, if they were on surgery up at our place, they'd be third, you know, assistant, and maybe they could see something and maybe they couldn't, and they'd be at the end of a retractor, and they were kind of low man on the totem pole. So they really liked those rural rotations. And so then they were interested potentially in becoming rural surgeons instead of rural family doctors. So one of the medical students wanted to be a rural surgeon, and he said, let's find out what the needs are. And I said, well, I think the needs are great because we keep getting these phone calls. So we surveyed all the surgeons who practiced 10 or more miles from a population center of 30,000 or more, and found out the age of the surgeons, their future plans, the spectrum of the cases they do, and what they wish they'd learned in residency. We found out that at that time, their average age was 47, and it has gotten older now. They had been for a mean of 15 years in practice, and the vast majority felt training should be widened for optimal rural practice, and they listed what some of the most needed skills were. But the challenges to establishing a rural surgery experience at that time were turf issues, which in our place were the unwillingness of specialists to train their competition, and then funding the program and finding a setting that was rural but not so rural that the resident wouldn't see an adequate volume. So we got a sort of a serendipitous answer because one of our residents had grown up in this little town 3.5 hours south of Portland, little community of 35,000, which isn't that small, but it had a high quality hospital of about 100 beds and an ambulatory surgery center where they did a lot of endoscopy. And it had a rural feel, forests, a wild and scenic river, lots of outdoor activities. And they had both 7 board-certified general surgeons in this hospital of 100 beds, and also specialists in GYN, ortho, urology, ENT, all eager to mentor a senior surgical resident, for obvious reasons, and also a supportive hospital administration that wanted to have something special that would set them apart from the other sort of larger rural hospitals in Oregon. And we also had, and this is that hospital, it was a really nice looking hospital. And we had this resident who'd grown up there and he wanted to be the first one to go down there and pilot this. So we designed this as in discussion with the surgeons down there. None of them had ever been in an academic program and had trained residents. So they were a little nervous about having a resident and turning over their cases and their care of their patients to a revolving door of every 6 weeks or 2 months another resident. And they insisted it be a one-year, an entire year experience, which because they, you know, beggars can't be choosers right then, we kind of went along with this thinking that also it would model something more durable. If you spent an entire year there, you'd know, have a better chance of knowing, is this going to be something I can do long term? And also to be modeling what it would be like to be in practice and fulfilling some of the aspects of rural practice that you don't do in the academic urban setting, and that is have better longitudinal care and continuity of care with your patients. Not only do you see them in the clinic post-op, but you see them in the grocery store when they lift up their shirt and say, hey, how's my incision healing, doc? So it would model that pretty well. And it was an ideal environment there, and we got everything all arranged so that it would meet all the requirements for ACGME. Initially, we had the structure, the idea we would have 6 months of general surgery and then have rotations in these other specialties. But after a while, we realized that that was not the greatest idea because the specialty acute problems that came in wouldn't necessarily follow that schedule. And so we modified it into a general surgery overall year with targeted experiences in the surgical specialties. When they would come into the emergency room, then the resident would get called and would take part in those as well and spend some time during the week in seeing those patients when they come back to clinic and so on. So it modeled what actual surgical practice would be like, working with partners, interacting with referring MDs and consultants, learning something about practice and office management, learning something about billing, and having better continuity of care than in most of our residency programs. The experience down there was amazing, really. Over 400 major cases, over 200 minor procedures in endoscopy in 1 year without violating the 80-hour work week because it wasn't that horribly busy, and also the structure of the rotation followed the rules. And then having those basic and emergency procedures in the specialties. We arranged teleconferencing from OHSU available, streaming so that they could, and then also they could look at it later if they were in the OR when the conference happened. They have, of course, online learning and through SCORE curriculum and things like that. And then they have a local M&M and journal club. And so it started out way back in 2002-03 as the pilot year, the resident who had grown up in Grants Pass. And then one resident who had an interest in rural practice, we were trying to get RRC approval for that year to count as a year of residency. In the initial stages, it was an elective year in lieu of a research year, because there were some residents who didn't want to do a research year. They wanted to do general surgery and particularly rural or global practice, and they really didn't want that research year. But it hadn't been approved yet by the RRC in those days for it to count. So it ended up being an extra year, and they couldn't count their cases, but they had the experience. And then we finally, in those days, the RRC did not like the idea of a rural track. They said all residents have to have the same experience. But they said we'd consider it if it was an elective site for training. So we reapplied, and they finally approved it way back about a decade ago as a site of training for one resident, and then we showed that that resident had a great experience, passed the board exams, and did fine. So they then allowed us to have two residents that would have it count as their residency year, and then it went on from there. So we, after about 10 years of having this program in place, we looked at residents who had completed that year. We wanted to see, does it really work that if they complete that rural year, will they be more likely to enter general surgical practice in a rural or a small town community than other residents in our program, and also less likely to complete a specialty fellowship before entering practice. So we looked at the residents who had finished residency and had entered practice already since 2002, and we looked at the group that had gone down to Grants Pass and then all the rest, and looked at their residency files, their demographics, what their initial career choice had been when they entered residency. Did they say they wanted to be a general surgeon? Did they say they wanted to be a rural surgeon? Or did they say they wanted to be a specialist, and if so, what type and locale? And then we looked at what they eventually ended up doing. Our primary endpoints were, did they complete a fellowship? Did they currently practice general surgery? And did they practice in a setting of less than 50,000 population, which is large rural? The secondary endpoint was whether their initial career plans had changed. And then we compared the data using Fisher's exact test. So we had the two groups, the group of it's a small group at that point of 11 that had completed the rural program, and then 59. We have a large program. At the time we started, it was only about 7 or 8. Now it's actually one of the largest in the country, 13, but that's only been very, very recent. So the total number that were that didn't go down to Grants Pass and just were trained completely in Portland was 59. And so it was interesting. We were a little disappointed, I guess, that there wasn't a statistical difference in the number who had completed fellowship, the percentage compared to rural, to the ones who'd stayed in Portland. But there was a distinctly great difference in who practiced general surgery, 91% of the group that had gone to Grants Pass versus only 47 that had stayed in Portland. And also, that although the numbers are small, practice site less than 50,000, it was also a distinct difference. So the question is it nature or nurture? Did those individuals go to Grants Pass because they already wanted to do general surgery and particularly rural surgery, or could it make a difference in their eventual career if they did go down there? You'd say, well, if somebody was interested in a specialty, why would they spend a year down in Grants Pass? And I think one of the big incentives was that the residents who came back from Grants Pass said, oh gosh, we operated up a storm. We did all these great cases. We did so many cases. We had this great experience. And one of the things about current residents is they're told you're not going to get a good enough experience. You're not going to be confident enough when you finish. And so even people who thought they might want to do a specialty who said, well, if I go down there, I'll really be a better surgeon and I'll get to do all these lots of cases. So we did have five people out of the 11 who came into residency wanting to do a specialty, went down there, and four out of that five ended up staying in general surgery. There were a few also who came in wanting to do specialty, who stayed in general surgery, who were up in Portland in the other group, but there was a statistical difference in that respect. So overall, 31% of residents changed their minds about specialty during their residency, and that's a number that's fairly constant across the years. So there is a real opportunity, if they get exposure that really excites them, to potentially stay in general surgery and maybe even in rural surgery. So the other question, when we saw that there were a lot of residents who'd gone down to Grants Pass that still did do a fellowship, those fellowships were usually critical care or MIS, or it's one case colorectal. Does completing a fellowship mean that an individual is lost to general surgery? And actually, that's not the case. So if you look at statistics saying, oh, 80% of residents do fellowships and therefore they're not general surgeons, that's really not the case. Many people who do fellowships are entering general surgery practice. And those fellowships are commonly ones where you still will be practicing general surgery after you finish, like such as trauma and surgical critical care, minimally invasive surgery, and in some cases, colorectal surgery, because if you are a colorectal surgeon and go into a group, you may be still doing general surgery call and having a fairly significant proportion of your practice be general surgeon surgery. So I think the answer there is no. So our findings were that a rural experience in residency did increase the chances that a graduate would practice general surgery rather than a specialty. And as I said, the likelihood of completing a fellowship did not differ. But doing a fellowship did not preclude entering general surgery practice. The residents who went to Grants Pass were more likely to enter residency wanting a rural or general surgical practice. But if you entered the residency wanting to pursue a specialty and then spend a year down there, there was a likelihood that they might stay in general surgery. So we concluded that rural experience did help, and that doing a fellowship in something doesn't necessarily mean they won't go into general surgery. Here's two of the graduates. Megan Frost is from Kansas originally, and but not from rural Kansas, but she likes rural outdoors and fishing, and so does her husband, and they practice in the community of Grants Pass. They went back, and she's one of our faculty there. And Jason Lanton came to us thinking about doing specialty, but the idea, he'd had a global surgical experience in medical school, and then he decided to go to Grants Pass and is now practicing in the thriving community of Soldotna, Alaska, population 6,000, and has done a lot of international experience. So those are just sort of two examples. Limitations of this small study are that it's small, one residency program, and sometimes there were some inadequate data about the residents' background in their files. It didn't say whether they fished or hunted small or large game, and sometimes not where they had grown up. But anyway, so after our experiences, and there's a little more that will be right at the very end here in a few minutes about our second site, but after having develop this program and a second site. The considerations in building a rural general surgery training program, which I shared with Bob McDonald on the phone and have talked about at the program directors meeting, trying to drum up even more interest for more places to have either a separate track or part of their residency be at a rural setting, are it's really important to select your site well. And funding, of course, is always the big bugaboo. Who pays for it? Getting the contracts all aligned so that it, all the lawyers and all the places are happy. And also making sure that the educational content is good. And then ACGME approval. A lot easier nowadays because there's a recognition now in the last few years that general surgery training and rural surgery is very important in order to preserve access to surgical care for our population. And so there's a more favorable view toward programs now than there ever was when we first started, I'd say. Site selection is that it needs to be small, but not too small. You can't have the only rural experience be a critical access hospital, or your volume isn't high enough to and it will hurt the numbers of procedures that the residents get if it's a year of their training or a substantial portion. The rotations either have to be very small, short, or else you have to be in a large enough hospital that's a rural setting, but a fairly large rural setting. But the critical thing is the absence of competing learners. No surgical specialty like urology residents or ortho residents or otolaryngology or, you know, even plastics or fellows. And you have to be really careful about the surgeons you select as your faculty, that they have a good skill set and interest, skill set not as surgeons just, but as also as teachers, and are willing to help in mentoring and training the residents in their practices. And then the spectrum of cases that are done there has to be available. The big endoscopy experience, which is such an important part of rural practice. And then the bread and butter general surgery and C-sections and basic orthopedics, urology, and ENT. And then a motivated hospital administration who really wants to have our residents there. For our programs, the funding has come from the host hospital. If the host hospital has not had a residency, they can qualify for new Medicare funding, but they have to make that application because it's, and as rural hospitals, that's they can get that. It's hospital supported, usually as an alternative to mid-level providers. And as we all know, one resident is a far more economic benefit to the hospital than it takes two mid-level providers because they only work 40 hours a week rather than 80, and they cost a lot more actually to get. So that should be attractive to the hospital, but they have to be amenable and excited about that. And then living costs and available housing are also important, and having it provided by the hospital is ideal. There are some states that have funding for such programs, and some states have developed rural programs through state funding. Our state legislature can't get it together to do anything like that, so it had to come from the hospitals themselves. And of course, contracting. You have to have a master contract, a program letter of agreement. It really does take longer to get these things organized than you would think should be the case, but it's because there are lawyers involved on both sides. And then we have to make sure the rules are very well spelled out. Educational content is important, making sure that all the ACGME regulations are complied with, that they're going to do evaluations, that they report their work hours, and then the conferences are in place. And then ACGME approval, which, as I mentioned, was harder when we started our programs, and actually now has become a lot more favorable because of the favorable look at the need for general surgeons. So right now, we added a rotation in down on the South Coast in Coos Bay, which we got the faculty there to agree to 6-month rotations rather than 1 year. And so that actually triples the number of residents per year that can do a rural rotation. It still remains an elective, but it is counted as the cases count for their for boards. And their third or fourth year in our case. Coos Bay is a community and a hospital similar in size to Grants Pass. They have a smaller number of general surgeons, though, and more specialists. Specialists are all willing to work with the general surgery residents. They even have a hand surgeon, a plastic, fully boarded hand and plastic surgeon down there, who happens to be the first resident who went to our Grants Pass program, didn't stay a rural general surgeon, did plastic surgery, but is now in rural hand surgery, which is an incredibly valuable experience for our residents. So out of 13 residents, 6 out of the 13 are able to have an in-depth rural experience. And that's the hospital down in Coos Bay, which is, again, a really nice, beautiful hospital, very, you know, modern, state-of-the-art facility. So training surgeons who will practice in rural areas is necessary to train them slightly differently, but it's also not sufficient, as I alluded to before. There are other specific issues that must be addressed, and we in our state are trying to address those as well, and I think a lot of other states' pattern is kind of moving, shifting in that direction. Call burden, as I mentioned, is a big thing, and many places now need to get locum tenens if they're a critical access hospital with only one or two surgeons, and those surgeons also need to take vacation, and they need to have a little respite, and they need to go perhaps to meetings and learn new skills and things like that. So cooperation among regional providers and hospitals is very important. What the scope of practice is going to be for those surgeons is important. It must be appropriate for the local resources. Maybe laparoscopic three-field esophagectomy or bariatric surgery might not be the most appropriate procedures for a critical access hospital where there are 2 units of blood in the hospital and no really well-supplied ICU. And then a system of care needs to be developed that has good bidirectional communication to optimize care. And that means that, you know, when the patients truly are too complex or too ill to stay in that location, or there are needs for advice, there needs to be a steady, good communication flow to the next available hospital or an academic center to really be able to have dialogue and know, okay, should we take this patient? Is it going to be too complicated? And then have a return agreement so that the patient, when they're doing fine, can go back to get the remainder of their care back closer to home. And then kind of working to improve the local resources in the hospital so that it's optimal for that general surgeon so that they don't feel stressed by the question, can I really take care of this patient? And improving the practice environment. And so that's really, I think, one of the most important things we're working on now is to try to develop regionalized systems of care that really involve a true cooperation and partnership among all the stakeholders. And it involves the need for rural surgeons, rural hospitals, rural communities, and also academic medical centers and the American College of Surgeons, which has actually played a fairly large role recently under the leadership of J. David Richardson as the chair of the Board of Regents. The American College of Surgeons put in place the first new advisory council in 50 years, and that's the Advisory Council for Rural Surgery. And there have been some really great thoughts and programs that have already developed in improving the communication among rural surgeons nationally so that they feel like they're better supported and not just out there practicing in a remote environment all alone with nobody to call on. There's still, though, more that needs to be done that we're working on in that respect. Ways to improve the practice environment in the rural setting are, some of the support from the hospital and better working relationships between the hospital and the surgeons that would help very much. Salary and benefits and malpractice paid by the hospital, just like we have it in our urban environments. Debt relief for defined length of service. I mean, as all of you are only too acutely aware, the debt of people finishing training now is really great. And having a program where if you stay in that setting for 5 years, you get 20% of your debt taken care of for each year that you stay there, and having that in a contract would be a nice incentive, I think. And then providing locum tenens relief, and one of the things we're working on rather than, and we do locally in Oregon, is for our rural hospitals, we have some surgeons some of them are older and about ready to retire, and some of them are younger and haven't yet built their practices up completely, that spend a period of time going to be locum tenens relief for some of the rural hospital surgeons so that they can attend a meeting or take a vacation and help make their lives a little better from the standpoint of the incessant call. And then again, partnering both for consults and for patient care, but also for online CME and for additional training in new procedures and technologies that we have, like in our simulation centers, that if we have rural faculty and they have academic appointments, then they can come up and learn new techniques and be involved in that, and then we can send someone down to be locum tenens for them. Additional ways that are still being worked on are to develop regionalized systems of care among critical access hospitals that are relatively close together with one larger hospital like Coos Bay so that people could share a call and not be on call quite so frequently. And that's being developed already in our Coos Bay South Coast environment. Not applicable to every place, because if there's only one critical access hospital that's 6 hours from any place else, then obviously it wouldn't be that feasible, and we'd need to use the locum tenens model for that. Of course, hospital employment is big now, and increasing percentage of surgeons are hospital employed rather than in a true private practice, solo practice model. Advantages are that it decreases practice overhead and the regulatory headaches and risks, which are looming so large. The more different abbreviations I hear of all the different rules that they keep spinning out, it just is mind-boggling, and I can't figure out what those initials mean. And I am very happy that I never had to worry about those and run a practice and employ people and meet all those regulations. So having hospital employment is a help in that regard. It gives the opportunity to have a more predictable, structured practice and a predictable and steady income rather than just dependent upon what comes in the door. But, of course, there is a loss of autonomy. So what is really some of the factors driving this trend are the predictable constant income for the physician, decreasing the need to hire and fire, run a business, invest in an EMR system, and meet all those other demands. And also for the hospital, providing reliable physician coverage of service needs. But the caveats are that the agreement has to be fair to everybody. It needs to provide guaranteed compensation for the surgeon, but spell out their duties and include a reasonable call schedule. And then also designed to assure and hopefully increase the surgeon productivity and quality of care. But it requires mutual trust and alignment of goals between the surgeon and the hospital. As I receive every day and read many, many, many online rural listserv entries from surgeons, I can really attest to the fact that if you've seen one rural hospital, you've seen one rural hospital, and their differences are very great. So when people are looking at where to go into practice, it's important to really analyze and drill down into the weeds and see what's really going on out there and make sure that you do have alignment of goals between what are your goals and what are the hospital's goals if you enter into a hospital employment situation. But I think still, if we work together as academic institutions, as communities, and as whole states, that we may yet see a bright future for rural general surgery. And with that, I'll close and answer any questions that you have.